which if you look at last year, it's down about 27%. If you look at just hours, you take dollars out of it, and compare it to calendar 14 and calendar 13 on hours based, you know, wage rates are different than they were a couple years ago. Current number rates down anywhere from 14 to 17%. I think that's indicates there's a pretty good positive trend, which is continuing. Jeff and his team are really focused on this. They work every week, both at the departmental level as well as at the individual level. This is a snapshot of the top earners. So last year, in December, for calendar 16, we, you know, we looked at the top earners, and as you recall, we had some folks over 300,000, more than 20, over 200,000. On the left side of this chart, you can see for the first 11 months of calendar year 15, the top 200 earners in this case earned about $32 million. That's down 16% this year. On an individual basis, last year, at this time, we had about 13 employees who had already earned over $200,000, and some were headed to 300. This year, you know, we're down at one. So I expect we'll finish the year with more than one person having broken the $200,000 mark, and that'll break 300, and the numbers will be a lot less. The individuals tend to be in some of the same areas they were with this last year, which is signals, signals making some power payments. But generally, I think you see a very positive continued trend overall and with the individuals. And then this is just a quick snapshot for the first 3 months of fiscal 17 versus fiscal 16. So this is the July, August, September period of this year versus July, August, September period last year. Down about 16% dollars. We'll be updating these figures once we close out the December numbers. We get 6 months of data. But I think the current run rate will, you know, will probably be around $40 million over time in fiscal 17. Down significantly from where we're at 15 and down probably $2-3 million from where we were because of 16.
I had a question on the previous slide. From my way of looking at this, when you have these high earning positions, the issues you're dealing with are either concentration of scheduling, one individual is getting scheduled for a lot of overtime, or you have specific positions where a lot of overtime is needed. I think they're both symptomatic, likely, of shortages in staff. And I guess is there any ability to kind of filter that back through the HR process that we've been talking about to try to get to the staffing level, not only the appropriate staffing level so that more of this is done on straight time, and then also control for perhaps a concentration where one or two individuals is getting the bulk of overtime and perhaps a more equitable distribution makes more sense.
So I think a couple of the top earners fall into both those categories. And actually, one of the top earners in particular, who was a top earner for us last year as well, for the first 6 months of this year, vacancies also play a significant role in the amount of overtime this individual had. Those vacancies now have been filled, and we now have people that have actually been filling in and working in those positions that have actually helped reduce the amount of overtime that this one particular individual is following. I think taking it back to a higher level is obviously something that we're watching, something that we're monitoring, and certainly, Brian has made it clear, and the team has made it clear that if we, myself, Eric Stuhoff, and really the directors in charge of each of the respective divisions feel that we do need to add additional staff in these areas due to the amount of work that's necessary, they're willing to do that. But again, the majority of the overtime that some of these high earners saw and accumulated was during the first few months of this year where we did have vacancies.
Back with a refresh update as we close up the year.
That's great. Continues to be encouraged.
Yeah.
Good to work for
them. Thank you.
All right, let's go to item D, report of the Chief Operating Officer.
Okay. So good afternoon. Wildlife vegetation gets pulled up, obviously, to all of you here, unfortunately, for many of us, both here is in the air. And what I've asked to do and would like to do during my remarks today is have Todd Johnson come up and give an update to us on where we are for winter preparedness within the operations division. And Eric is here as well that also can help answer any questions that may have gone through that presentation. While the presentation gets pulled up, last week we actually did take a bit of a dip on our performance on the red line. Our performance was about at 9% level for the week. And we usually hover around 92, 93% during the peak period. What we saw last week was on Monday morning, we had two trains go disabled about an hour apart during the morning rush. And early morning, we also had a slippery rail condition between Braintree and JFK. And if you recall, that was the morning we had a little bit of residual goo, and it obviously froze on the rail slightly. So that contributed, really helped it to work into our delay that we had in service, at least on Monday morning. And Monday morning's peak performance itself was about 85%, but that was enough to bring the damage down for the day. Also, jumping ahead, one of the other items that I wanted to discuss was the overnight survey. Right now, we actually have over 6,000 people respond to our survey so far on overnight, so we're really excited about that. We now have the printed versions of the survey available that all of our partners have distributed, and at this point, things are going very, very well. One of the little tidbits that I think is worth mentioning that we do not have a link yet that actually links from our homepage of the website to the survey itself. That's actually being corrected immediately. Just something that we recently discovered. But again, we have 6,000 people that have actually participated in this right now. I'm really excited.
We've been dealing with different constituencies. Anything about the profile of those responses, and in particular, I know with my late doctor here, wanted to make sure that the hotel and restaurant workers, in particular the service workers, they might participate in that. Do we have any ability on the same rules back reporting?
Yes, so right now, I do not, paper surveys that are coming back, we do not have any responses because of the update that I got earlier this morning. We don't have an update for the paper surveys as of yet. What we do know is both the SEIU and the Mass Hotel Restaurant Workers Associations are distributing the surveys out to their members. So we will be getting an update on that kind of real time as they come in. The Office of Performance Management, Rachel Bain and Laurel, are doing a fantastic job of kind of getting all this data collected for us and really beginning to process that for us, which needs to get more.
That'd be great. I think we certainly want to push those responses to those constituencies.
So with that, I mean, Todd, I know we're kind of flying blind here, but that's all right.
Yep. Thank you, Jeff. Good afternoon, Secretary, Chairman, members of the Board, General Manager. So as Jeff said, I'm here today to give an update on operations, the operation for Congress preparation for this year's winter season. I was here probably about 4 weeks ago and gave an update to the Board. As I said then, this the preparation begins many months ago, really when last winter ended, the preparation for this year began, and it's going very well. As we know, preparation over the last 2 years, a big part of that has been the Winter Resiliency Project. So the Winter Resiliency Project Phase 2 continues to advance. The project is presently on schedule. We have three additional weekend service diversions scheduled for the month of December. To complete more work. The additional weekends, we will be completing the replacement of the third rail and the replacement of the third rail here at LAX during those three diversions. And that's between, this year's work was taking place between Wollaston and Braintree Station, but we were also completing third rail and third rail here and replacement between JFK and Ashland during this phase too.
These are going to be only on the red line, the weekend shutdowns?
That's correct. Yep. On the red line. So this weekend we have, we actually have two shutdowns this weekend to try to accelerate the work. We'll be busing between Ashland and JFK and also between Braintree and Quincy Adams. So Braintree and Quincy Adams is a smaller section, so we'll be implementing two diversions to try to expedite the work with the goal of completing all the work prior to the winter weather arriving.
So I do want to point that out. That's something really unique that we're doing right now, which we're really changing gears. Our customers are going to see two diversions on the red line now next weekend in order for us to really get and use this time as efficiently as we possibly can.
And we've been communicating that on the Karyn platform.
Yep. So station signage has been on the website, and we also are making public addressing, so pushing it out through our social media, Twitter, and other efforts. The slide's not up, but we are, just to point out, we are a little bit
behind on the heater element infrastructure. Not too far, but that was just due to some unforeseen problems with infrastructure. So as the crews were laying some of that infrastructure, they come across some duct banks and things that were in the ground that they didn't expect. But they do expect to get back on track and still complete the project that's scheduled.
If you just refer to the page.
Okay.
So just a question. So
yes.
So in the world of what you're doing, which is the winter resiliency work, and you can apply unexpected conditions in the field, do those conditions end up in sort of an as-built database so for future projects that condition is captured? Or how does that?
I believe they do, but I'll let Eric.
Yes. This is not an easy question.
They do. They are as-built. We as-built those conditions. So as they identify the banks that were not on the as-built that we had prior to before, particularly because they would have just record drawings, they are captured as part of the as-built process.
Okay, great.
Moving on to page three, a little bit about infrastructure preparation. So our engineering maintenance teams are nearing completion of our infrastructure preparedness for this winter, which includes installing many miles of snow fencing along the right way to prevent the snow from drifting and leaning onto the tracks. Also includes covering almost 300 plus track switches with covers to prevent snow and ice from building up in them when we do get some adverse weather, as well as, you know, watering winter supplies such as shovels, salt, sand. And similar to last year, we will have additional contracts in place for outside companies if the need arises for snow removal to come in and supplement the MBTA forces to remove snow from our property. Our vehicle maintenance is nearing completion of our non-revenue and revenue vehicles preparation. This includes 52 off-road snow fighting vehicles as well as 60 over-the-road vehicles. Our revenue fleet is just about complete with its preparation. This year, we will have an increase of 40 cars or trains equipped with snow plows. That's an increase of 100%. We had 20 on each the orange and red line last year. We will increase that to 40. The orange line has 80 spare traction motors in stock, and the orange line has 41 spare traction motors. Anti-icing equipment has been installed on all three of the heavy rail vehicles, and they are ready for deployment. On the slides you have in front of you, you'll see we are a little bit behind on the winter equipment preparation, and that's easily explained. A lot of the rail-borne, not a lot, but there's a number of rail-borne vehicles that we use dual purpose. So a lot of them are used to clear snow from the track as well as to perform track maintenance. Our track construction season goes all the way up to December 18th. So the week of December 18th, those vehicles will then be prepped with snow fighting equipment on board, and then they'll be ready to go by January 1st. The last slide, 2 weeks ago, we completed our 2016-17 snow plan that has been finalized, and it's been distributed to all of the operations managers. We have also continued our outreach to our transportation partners. It has been completed. We have tried over the years to increase the number of outside organizations and partners in transportation to retweet or redistribute our service alerts when we do have issues on the system during adverse weather. As you know, the customer winter campaign was launched by the customer experience team, which promotes different ways that customers can receive service alerts throughout the winter. This week, operations has an equipment deployment drill scheduled for this upcoming Thursday night. So we will take this non-revenue period Thursday into Friday and deploy a lot of the snow fighting equipment that has been prepared as a dry run to our winter. If you look at the slide, we're a little bit in the yellow, and that's just because the drill is scheduled for this weekend. So we are tightening up a couple of last loose ends, and we will be executing that drill this Thursday night. The stone desk and field coordinator training was completed last week on November 21st and 22nd. We had over 70 operations managers complete that training over the 2 days. And with that, overall operations feels well prepared and stand ready to keep the system up and running for the winter months.
Great. Thank you. Great work.
All right. Thank you.
And apologies to the public for the computer glitch, but this is posted on our website, so we have to look at that. Why don't we jump right into IDB, Commuter Rail Service Pilot Program Policy? So that maybe is better.
Jim.
Thank you.
Very good. How are you? So, we're here today to talk about the beginning development of a draft pilot service policy. The MBTA has been approached by several entities seeking pilots. They include the Board of Commuter Rail Service, Hospital Commuter Rail Service, Old Commuter Rail Service at the GP Brewer stop in Lynn, Ferry Service, and Overnight Bus Service in Boston. We currently don't have a formal policy. We are, however, working on some of these issues as we speak. For example, at night bus service, we're developing metrics, right? MI is taking lead on that. So, we'd like to develop policy. I think these are one-offs. I think it's very important that people who are proposing understand what our metrics are for both starting and judging policy. So, we would recommend that there be an advice sponsor. Sponsoring in a framework for determining whether the proposal meets our minimum criteria and evaluating effectiveness throughout the pilot and at the end of the pilot so we can make a decision prior to triggering FDA at the agency. So, at minimum, policy obviously should look at ridership, operating cost effectiveness, operational impact on the rest of the MBTA system, as well as capital costs. I'm going fast.
You might as well be telling me.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, I think so. The hope was, especially as we get to each of these criteria, we would love feedback so that staff can give you a back of draft policy.
And for the board, just an update on schedule. We're still waiting for someone else to arrive, so we have about another 15 minutes to go.
I got two reactions to this, and you do address it somewhat in later slides, so I just want to bring it up now while it's time right now. Say we haven't addressed it later. One would be maybe to put a finer point on the operational impacts. Operational impacts on the system as currently constituted at current resource levels, and what additional resource levels would be required to not only get the current system up to what we consider, above our operating targets plus the new service. Sort of as we, some of these come over the transom, given our current performance, particularly on commuter rail, I'm hard pressed to see how we do both. The other one on capital costs, I would urge that we not only look at capital costs in terms of what are hard construction dollars, but are there ancillary costs associated with starting a new service? I'm mindful of expansions we've done. Ask for mitigation has been a meaningful and material expense, and to the extent, again, a handful of these proposals have come forward and the reaction has suggested not every surrounding community fully understands or has been included in the process, to the extent that that is an indicator that there would be potential ancillary costs like mitigation, would urge that those be captured.
In the world of capital costs, let's make sure we're including maintenance costs and life cycle replacement costs as well.
Yes, sir.
And again, as Steve talked about, the strain on our maintenance facilities, rolling stock, back in house operations, et cetera. But I have a sort of a broader question, which is you need to think about, is this sort of a first come, first serve process where people just write to us throughout the year and we react on whether a particular project meets certain standards or not, or should we go some kind of call for projects, annual call for projects, where we look at those, we rank on them against the criteria, and perhaps agree to fund as a pilot only a certain amount of them. Those that don't get funded will get back in the queue and think about how they can improve their proposal for next year. You thought about procedurally, anything like
that? No, we
would always.
What we've thought about is we've got these queued up already. And so this was an attempt to sort of get control of the policy before we started taking one off. That being said, we're going down tomorrow to present to the town of Foxborough and Foxborough Rail Service. And then to the parish point about community county mitigation, we're going to Walpole present on the same service first week of December.
And you're in the middle of running a survey on overnight service, which may have started as a mitigation, but given that FTA made it clear that we have no further obligation to the first pilot, it is now essentially a new service.
Yep.
So, but the point you raised, Mr. Chairman, which is in the future, do we want to have a more organized process, makes sense. For the moment, the staff's concern has been able to come back to whether it's on overnight service in Foxborough or Corn or Ferries, and at least be able to present you with the information you want about it. Absolutely, the policy could include a process as well as the assessment
criteria. And also, given that the board's adopted an unsubstantive proposal policy, it might make sense for the board to get ahead of this issue and decide whether you want to judge them all, say, come in, or group them and judge them all at a certain time.
And this is really, I think I'd like to hear the rest of staff's sort of initial views on this. You know, because there are also a whole bunch of other things that I'm sure each of us have heard about. There's a potential West Station. Did that come from us? Did that come from somebody else? I can see that on the list. I feel that they get people around a station at one land. Is that on the list? They're not written. So I just worry that there's this list, but there's a whole bunch of other stuff we've heard reference to in the 16 months we've been here. So I want to make sure somehow that folks are sort of somewhat formed up. They don't lose sort of 18 months because they won't get it. This just set of things. Others views on this? Or?
No, go ahead. No. My only point was another piece of this is there are projects that we've been treating more as capital expansions because there is a track or river station, and the West Station is an example of that, and that is sort of in the expansion process, either in the CIP or post 40. These are more things where there are some capital costs, but primarily people are asking for a service that we really would be in a position to run with existing assets. So there is a station in Foxborough, we actually run there with football games, and there's trade service on the line. But you're right, so one question would be, at what point does it cross over from being primarily service subject to this policy to primarily capital subject to the CIP and the supporting process? That's another question.
This may be something we need to think about.
I guess my thought would be, ideally we'd like to have sort of a comprehensive universe of projects to choose from. That said, it strikes me that perhaps there's a threshold where somehow below it, if you're below a certain threshold where the marginal cost of the service is truly incremental, and I guess I'm going to require some convincing that any of these is truly incremental, maybe you would let those go to the front of the queue for consideration if you felt like the ridership was there. But then everything else above that threshold, and I suspect most of these will be above the threshold I'd be comfortable with, would be part of a broader strategic process. So again, we're not picking the people who show up and sort of ask first. So ridership, obviously, ridership is one of our primary drivers. So to that extent, each pilot will have to have an estimate of ridership, staff. And we also, where we can, like the graphics and passengers. The other issue is that you will have some kind of ridership metric for each type of project that you have to meet. As an example, commuter rail pilots,
the users here at 25th percentile, the 5th percentile, it is what happened, a robust enough metric that not everybody can make it, but possibly not so high a metric that nobody can make it. Obviously, these are pilots, they're supposed to be, to have the service for a defined period of time to prove their worth or not. If you said that in poverty, nobody gets it.
On ridership, can we also be thoughtful about potentially cannibalizing other forms of public transportation? Yes, we want net new riders.
Yes, absolutely.
Again, mindful of the Greenbush experience, and also thinking about Foxborough's sort of the one before us, given that there are other lines in close proximity.
It doesn't move to the open station of Foxborough, you're just capturing. Operating cost effectiveness. It's not enough to get a ridership. You also have to be mindful of the cost per rider. We put up here for you the subsidy per rider for each of our services. These are 2015 numbers. We developed from the IOTMI. So you could have the requirement to pilot meet the average subsidy per rider. So if you're a commuter rail pilot, and your subsidy per rider is going to be higher than 656, you might not be cut. There are all lots of places where you have to do some thresholds on overnight bus service, for example. It's not necessarily fair to judge overnight service compared to the entire subsidy.
I would just add a cautionary note there on looking at the subsidy by line, in that I go back to something Director Popak said, which is I think we need to be careful about making sure that if we look at these numbers and compare against those numbers, that that's optimal performance, not current performance, right? Because I think I too am concerned on commuter rail that the way in which we're operating today is not optimal performance, which may mean that the cost per rider is lower than it needs to be a better level of performance, right? So I would just say we need to be careful about using these as absolute numbers.
Yeah, and following on that, what's the denominator in the cost effectiveness? What's in the upper rate? What's in the cost side of the equation? Is it capturing rolling stock replacement?
It's open in, it's not capped.
Can we also have, just so we can understand as we're thinking about it, what is the full subsidy for each one of these elements when you include the capital side, the same repairs in life cycle assessment product?
Yeah. Also, importantly, we talked about the failure to meet the subsidy could be mitigated by cut based on our analysis, cash on the paper and pilot, you can actually move the diet.
I do want to say this, we are in the business of subsidizing transit. It never pays for itself. So the issue is really how much the subsidy is, and we already subsidize services. So it would not be fair to say for people interested in new service, you have to break even. And there are many sending a signal from the board about kind of the range. It doesn't have to be a point either. It could just be a range, plus or minus X percent or median or something. But, overnight service, the restaurant associations, indicated they might be willing to put money on the table. So we need some metric to judge cost effectiveness so that if stakeholders end up with a service where the subsidy is higher than the policy would otherwise allow for, and they want to know, well, how much do they need to underwrite it to? That's an important question that certainly comes up a lot in conversations with folks about new services. So I think this is one of the more critical issues to try to be as clear as possible on in the policy, because it's not just an absolute yes or no when someone proposes a service. It, total subsidy needs to be this amount because that's what it costs, but this is the amount that T would put on the table
on the notion of subsidies. And while we are fully supportive of that and encourage it, I do think addressing the durability of the subsidy, particularly on the operating side, would be important. And also note that taking the transition from a pilot program to a permanent service is an enduring commitment for the MBTA, and if it is supported by subsidy, the subsidy as well should be enduring.
So then obviously this gets to the issue that we're talking about earlier. It's not enough to judge the pilot just on the pilot, but there's a different syntax investment system. It's very squishy right now. Basically what this is trying to say is if Jeff and his team say, capital costs. So obviously you want to assess capital costs. So there are two things. There's capital costs very pilot, and then there's capital costs if you go to full-time service. So first off, we think you should only judge certainly during a pilot, probably during the final, only funds expended by MassDOT. Again, private entity sponsor brings capital dollars. That reduces the capital cost of the program. However, everybody needs to remember that there are things you do in pilot that making full time trigger other investments. And that's something you have to always be mindful of when you're making that decision. It may be a good pilot, it may perform well, but it may trigger significant improvements at the same station. If you're on pilot today, the station exists today, but when it becomes full time commuter rail, and you want to be mindful as we're judging the pilot's success, whether it's a success that merits additional capital costs. Then other considerations, obviously, there are things that are sort of more nebulous that you need to be mindful of, and that includes the ability to leverage and support economic development. That includes the potential to reduce GHG emissions. We're getting ready to have a new regulation that requires us to assess, evaluate, and possibly mitigate GHG emissions. And finally, of course, our equity considerations are serving underserved Pacific communities and populations. Next steps. So we're going to go off based on what we said today. I should say that I think there's a good chance Fox Borough will come here before we have the final policy.
Right. And we're moving along on coordinating service. There was an article on the Globe over the weekend that indicated that Florida might be interested in coming back. They were here in April, as you may recall. The feedback was pretty negative, but if you set some parameters out, there's some ferry issues hanging out there. So I appreciate the chairman's comment about trying to have a more organized process, and we should think about that. But to the extent that you have feedback on this presentation or general thoughts on how you would like the staff to process and present these to you, we really appreciate that because, economic growth continues and the desire for transit continues even while we struggle with the existing system. So, have the luxury of just being paused indefinitely. I think it makes a lot of sense to organize the process of doing it on these better than we have.
Thank you. Right, the authority is requesting the board enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to matters on non-union personnel, collective bargaining, real estate, and litigation. I have determined that the general counsel concurs that the discussion of these matters in open session may have an adverse effect on the authority's negotiating position. Can I get a motion to enter into executive session to discuss these matters? Is there a second?
Second.
Owen, call the vote, please.
Director, please. Director, I'll answer. If it's not, Mr. Chair.
Yes. Again, this is an advisory. We expect to return in about 2 hours, so